number two on your Wednesday night slate upcoming between the Eureka Red Devils and the Blackburn Beavers. Again, second game of the night here in Eureka. Excited to bring this one to you. Spencer Davis, Levi Taylor joining me. Levi, the last time we saw these Red Devil men again on the road in Kentucky dropped against Spalding. Spalding 3-0 in conference play. This is a much more, not necessarily beatable team, but a team that the Red Devils are looking to avenge a loss to earlier.
Yeah, like you said, last time against this team, came up with a loss, unfortunately. They're going to be looking for revenge on their home floor tonight. Hopefully they can put it together and get the win tonight.
Yeah, Blackburn in that last matchup, they had four players in double digits. It was something that the Red Devils may not have been expecting. It wasn't something that really popped out on the stat sheet in terms of what Blackburn could do, but it certainly was really difficult for the Red Devils to kind of contend with. Guys like Darius Duff, Isaiah Talmadge, Brady Barr, and Tyson Johnson all in double figures. Levi, how do you try to stop a four-headed monster?
I mean, it's very difficult because, like you said, there's not a lot of teams that have four guys that can go and get double-digit points. But, I mean, it's all has to do with playing in your defense, playing in your system, making sure that you're cleaning up on the boards, making sure that you're not giving them extra possessions, extra opportunities to score, and just cleaning up the loose ends. It's really those loose ends that make the biggest difference in the ball game.
That was a game that Cody Bear had 22 points, a double-double as well. He had multiple rebounds. And Pee Wee Brown had 25. However, the last time that we saw the Red Devils, Pee Wee Brown only played in that first half. There was some sort of issue in the locker room we didn't get an official word on. The idea is that Pee Wee Brown's a full go today, but Levi, without Pee Wee Brown in that Spalding game, it was down to guys like Jonah Loft who put in 7-8 points off the bench.
I mean, like you said, we're going to need Pee Wee Brown to be on the floor tonight to have a chance to win. This is a team that's already beaten Eureka, and they're going to need a full effort from all their guys tonight in order to win this one.
Yeah, coming into this game again, Cody Bear off to another monster season. He's the SLAC reigning player, or the reigning SLAC player of the year, and it should be no surprise that he's in that conversation again. But Levi, basketball is a team sport, so as great as you can be, you got to have other supporting options. And Pee Wee Brown's been that second guy, but Ben Carter seemingly moved up into that third spot.
And having that third guy is very important in having an offense and having a basketball team. You can't just really have two guys that you're relying on. You got to have that third guy that can score and come off the bench and do whatever. So having that third guy is key to getting wins and putting together, you know, team chemistry and building up going on to the season.
It was a 71-60 win for Blackburn on the road in Carlinville against these Red Devils. And it's a game, again, with 60 points as an offense is not exactly what you're looking for. 71 points is pretty commendable defense, though.
Yeah, they played good defense, especially on a road environment, on a floor that you're not used to. And I've been to Blackburn's gym. It is a weird floor, and I'm sure it's very weird to play on. But tonight, you know, being on your home floor, in front of your home fans, although the students may be home for break, we still got some here. Hopefully they can get it together and come out with a win tonight.
Well, that's all we have for you on the pregame side of things. On the other side of this break, starting lineups, first half coverage, Blackburn, Eureka, at Christine Bonatti Bullwinkle Arena.
When people ask us who we are, we tell them we're problem solvers, opportunity creators, community builders, and change makers. We are Rotary. Around the world, our network of 1.4 million neighbors, friends, and leaders volunteer their skills, expertise, and resources to solve issues and address community needs. We are people of action. Join us, and together, we can make an even greater impact. Find out how you can get involved at rotary.org/action.
Eureka, Illinois, this place to be at, or if you're watching here on ECTV, looking to bring it to you. Ethan Hedge, the public address announcer with the starting lineups.
Casey Center for tonight's St. Louis Intercollegiate Athletic Conference game between the Blackburn Beavers and your Eureka Red Devils. Both Eureka College and the NCAA promote good sportsmanship by student-athletes, coaches, and spectators. We request your cooperation by supporting the participants and officials in a positive manner. Intimidating actions directed at officials, student-athletes, coaches, or team representatives will not be tolerated and are grounds for removal from the facility. Thank you for your cooperation. Now let's meet tonight's starting lineups. First, for the visiting Blackburn Beavers. A 6'3 sophomore from Spencer, Indiana, number 1, Caden Paquette. A 6'3 senior from St. Louis, Missouri, number 2, Isaiah Talmadge. A 6'4 sophomore from Waukegan, Illinois, number 3, Darius Duff. A 6'3 sophomore from Winnemac, Indiana, number 22, Tyson Johnson. And a 6'8 senior from Prairie View, Texas, number 25, Zach Kelsey. The Beavers are coached by Austin Kirby and assisted by Reed Rustin and Tim Marston. Now let's meet the starting lineup for your Eureka Red Devils. A 6'4 sophomore from Morton, Illinois, number 4, Ben Carter. And a 6-foot senior from Peoria, Illinois, number 5, Noah Persit. And a 6'2 junior from Peoria, Illinois, number 10, Pee-wee Brown. And a 6-foot junior from Rock Falls, Illinois, number 11, Jalen Johnson. And a 6'10 senior from Peoria, Illinois, number 24, Cody Bayer. The Red Devils are coached by Chip Wilde and assisted by Jessica Thorman and Jake Boyd, and managed by Zoe Wilde.
As we like to say, Levi, the usual suspects for the Eureka starting lineups.
Yeah, same look that we've seen from them in previous games. Look for Eureka to come out early and try to jump on the board quickly. When you get into these games, especially with the last meeting with Blackburn being so recent, when you get into these games where you're kind of looking for revenge, you seem to be a little bit more amped up. Not that you're not amped up for every game, but you're more amped up for these because you're trying to prove something in this game.
Oh, and expect a very spirited battle. These two teams certainly don't have any love between them, really. A very healthy rivalry. Paquette already going to work on Persich, and that's the thing, Levi, that Blackburn's going to try to do. They like their post work from their guards.
It's going to be interesting to see how Eureka matches up with that. It's going to be tough. I mean, you don't really see a lot of guards that are good in the post. Pee-wee Brown is one guard that I've seen that is very good in the post. So it'll be interesting to see how Eureka decides to defend that.
Cody Bear, a little head fake on Zach Kelsey. Contact, still a good bucket. That was another thing, Levi. You weren't there for that Blackburn game, but it was a game that Cody Bear and Pee-wee Brown, I think, shot a combined 2 free throws in that first half, and you know how they play their style of basketball. Seems a little tough to, you know, repeat. Really tough take by Isaiah Talmadge. Unlike the game we just called, the women's game, both teams already in the field goal column quickly. A 4-2 game right now. Both offenses clicking early. Talmadge knocking that one down. Blackburn with a quick 3-point lead. It's Jalen Johnson to transfer from Sauk Valley. Gets jumped and they will get Talmadge there on the call. And Levi, that's going to be very beneficial to Eureka if that's how they're going to call those hedge screens.
Yeah, they doubled him off the screen. And, you know, honestly, Ben Carter could have rolled. Probably would have been open. But doubled him off the screen. Got a little bit of hand fighting. Called a foul.
Persich. Successfully inbounding to Johnson. 16 on the shot clock. Johnson handing off Brown. Brown, nice move on Talmadge. Goes to the bucket and finishes.
And that's his game right there. He's very crafty going around the rim, going inside. Does a very good job taking the ball to the basket and always does it strong.
Kelsey with it. Handing off Paquette. Kind of just dribbling through the Eureka defense. Thought about a step back. Alex Natu picked off Brown. Brown on Duff. Brown, nice step through it. That's just one of those plays that you're not going to stop Pee-wee Brown.
No, I mean, I just got done saying he's very crafty around the rim, very crafty in the lane. especially in those fast break situations. He's very hard to stop.
It's Johnson to Paquette. Trying to work on Persich. He's going to try to post him up once again. Gets that right hand once more. This time is a miss and a rebound for Johnson. It's Persich. Double team. Nobody on Ben Carter. Ben Carter, a lot of room at the three-point line for him. Too strong. And a rebound for Duff.
Not necessarily a bad look, but would like to see the Red Devils move the ball a little bit more and look for a better shot. And not one so early in the shot clock.
Duff able to collect his own miss and reset for the Beavers. It's Tyson Johnson to Talmadge. Now with Duff. Paquette guarded by Carter. Seven on the shot clock. Back out. Tyson Johnson. Paquette run off the line. Going to be a tough shot blocked from Carter. And they're saying a shot clock violation. Just confused for a second because that whistle went before the buzzer did, but they're electing not to put the time back up. 17-22 remaining in the first half, just underway in Eureka, Illinois. Slyak matchup number four for both of these teams. Blackburn comes in this one 2-1. Red Devils 1-2 in conference. Both 3-5 overall. Brown, tough hesitation move, can't convert.
Not a bad look, but still, I mean, Eureka's offense, we see this several times where they kind of get stagnant and kind of stand around.
Paquette said hand down, man down. Blackburn moves in front after the three.
But going back to Eureka's offense, would like to see him move around a little bit more, moving without the ball, could try to create some open shots.
Talmadge over Carter, tough take and finish. Also to note, Paquette probably not the guy you don't want to be tightly guarding out there, shooting 44% from three this year on plenty of attempts. Johnson, stagnant start to the possession for the Red Devils. Johnson, tough take, can't finish. Blackburn with a chance to push this out to a three-possession lead, perhaps. Duff inside, posting up on Brown. Forced to kick out with Johnson. Talmadge. Duff working on Brown again. Tough take, can't finish. It'll be an interesting game if they're going to continue to go isolation on Pee-wee Brown. Again, one of the Slack defenders of the year last year. Made first team all defense. Carter steps around the screen from Bear. And Paquette with a rebound.
Eureka starting to get a little bit stagnant on offense. Not moving the ball as much, not moving around as much. You need to move the ball and get those open shots.
Yeah, fortunately, I don't know if that was exactly the look that Coach Kirby was looking for. Brown, tough take and finish. Pee-wee Brown, 6 of Eureka's 8. Again, he didn't play in that second half against Spalding, so maybe some extra points in the chamber still. Kelsey going to try a 3 and knocks it in. You can see Coach Wilde kind of just signaling to his guys, hand up.
Yeah, I mean, just even putting a hand up makes a shot just that much more difficult. Not much to do. I mean, they're going to have to shoot over you.
It's Jalen Johnson guarded by Tyson Johnson. Brown, good body position to keep it away from Duff. Ben Carter getting a screen from Bear. Carter tried to yam on Kelsey. It's a miss. Talmadge pushing the other way. Good find. Duff, open look. And a miss, an unfortunate miss for the Red Devil defense. Play been at it for a while. Tough take there from Brown. Can't knock it in. See, Blackburn wants to play in transition. Duff gets called for a foul. Or excuse me, Brown gets called for a foul on Duff. Four subs into the game. 3 from Blackburn, 1 for Eureka. 14-14 remaining in the first half. It's a 5-point lead for the Beavers. Darius Duff at the free throw line. It'll be Blake Logsdon checking in for Jalen Johnson. It's Brady Barr, Cameron Johnson onto the floor for Blackburn. Also Sam DeJesus on for Carter. one more player coming onto the floor for Blackburn. I can't tell what his number is yet, but assuming he's coming in for the shooter, Duff. That will be the case. This is Otis Grisham.
Well, defensively, would like to see Eureka, as you said, Coach Wilde was kind of stressing to his team, get a hand up in the shooter's face. They're knocking down shots early here. Just get a hand up in their face. Makes it tougher for them to shoot, other than just being wide open with any without any contest.
Cool. Flip pass there, went off the foot, tried to save it, was Bear scrapping for it off the ground, cross court, logs in, the lefty three up, and knocked in. Red Devils loose, reducing the lead to three.
Really good find from Bear after losing the ball. It was kind of a broken play, but it worked out for him.
DeJesus, good block out there. Logs in the middle of the floor. Not every game we see Blake Logsdon in before Dylan, but that was the case. Also, you don't see a lot of Sam DeJesus, Cody Bear pick and rolls, but there we are. Bear, a lot of contact, ends up tipping it up. An offensive rebound for himself and puts it in. A lot of unconventional things going on there.
I'm not sure I've ever seen somebody spike the ball off the ground and then try to get a tip in off of it, but hey, however you can score, I guess.
Also, a guy like Cameron Johnson, number zero for the Beavers, likes to get down low in that kind of position. Blocked from DeJesus. It's Grisham, run off the line, trying to get over Brown. Can't finish there. DeJesus, another rebound. Not to be forgotten, Dylan Logsdon ready to check in. At the next dead ball, it's a one-point lead for the Beavers. Brown hands off, Persich, Bear. Going to go baseline. Tough take there for Cody Bear. Rolls out. And a rebound for Tyson Johnson. Cross court, Paquette into the corner. Grisham, three-pointer up from him. Too strong. DeJesus with his third rebound in the last 2 minutes.
Good job from Sam DeJesus and Pee Wee Brown recovering on the cross court pass. They had two guys wide open over there.
And a timeout taken by Coach Wilde. 20 seconds on the shot clock, 12:07 left in the first half. Eureka trailing 13-14 in Eureka.
Affects all corners of the world for good. I mean, if you think about organizations that affect an entire world, it's a short list. Taking care of kids is a priority. Taking care of the families as whole.
Without donations, without people that care for St. Jude and for the kids at St. Jude, our Max wouldn't be here.
You are making a difference, not just in a hospital, but in an entire world.
Welcome back to Eureka, Illinois. It's 14-13 in the fourth matchup between a couple of SLIAC teams. Well, fourth individual matchups. This is the second time these two teams have seen each other. It's Blackburn and Eureka. Spencer Davis and Levi Taylor with you. Noah Persich, Sam DeJesus, Cody Bear, Dylan Logsdon, and Blake Logsdon on the court. Blake Logsdon with it. Quick starts offensively for both sides. Dylan Logsdon able to force it down low. Bear contact, and he'll get two shots at the free throw line.
Really good entry pass from Dylan Logsdon, able to get it into Bear, who ultimately got fouled and is going line for two.
Cody Bear, 4 points tonight. You know, a couple minutes away from the halfway point of this half. First foul on Brady Barr. Barr, one of those guys that had double-digit points against the Red Devils last time out. He's the one with the rebound there. Tough take, Grisham to the bucket. Also, it's Cameron Hanvey onto the court as well, number 11. First time that the Red Devils have gotten a look at him.
Really good take from Grisham on that last offensive possession for Blackburn. Just was one-on-one with Blake Logsdon and took him all the way to the rack.
Logsdon tried to find Bear on that backdoor cut. Red Welt. Blackburn. Grisham Now Kanalikin. Good crossover from Grisham. Lost his footing, though. Ends up rolling out. Hanvey still with it. 11 on the shot clock. It's Barr. Kanalikin trying to drive onto Jesus. Logs in, trying to pick his pocket. Corner look from Grisham. Shot clock expiring. Lead back up to 5.
Not really sure what happened. Blake just left his man wide open in the corner. It was on the other side of the floor. It was wide open for the kick out.
And Grisham the foul in the backcourt. But again, guard depth is something that Blackburn has, and you can see Coach Kirby more than happy that he picks up a foul. Well, maybe not more than happy, but doesn't have a problem seemingly with him picking up a foul in that spot.
Yeah, I mean, this is a team that likes to apply pressure defensively. We've seen that so far in this game as part of their game plan. So you have to be willing to give up some fouls if you're going to play that way.
Blake logs in, guarded by Grisham. Using the pick and roll. Kicked out, swung, three-pointer to Jesus. Yes!
Really good inside-out ball movement, plus a swing to the corner for the Red Devils. Great vision from both the Logsden twins to get that open shot.
Get confusing with all those, both Logsdens out there sometimes. It's Cam Johnson getting the cut, can't convert. Sam DeHazer's usually not the tallest guy out there, nor is he going to jump the highest, but usually consistently with the best body positioning as he tips that to Dylan Logsden.
Yeah, he does a great job on the boards as he's found wide open right there on the baseline. He talked about positioning. He was in a great position right there for that layup.
And a really nice find there. I believe it was Cody Bear at the top of the key that slung that to him. Tied back up at 19. Looked like Grisham took a couple steps there after taking the ball, but maybe not. Brown almost with a steal. Again, something that Blackburn you'd think would be a little bit more mindful of is Brown's dominance in those passing lanes. Cameron Johnson off the court now. Micah Brewer and Jonah Loff on. It's Bear and Blake Logsden getting a break. Coach Kirby, the grandson of the Lincoln Rail Splitters head coach, Neil Alexander, one of the more, the most successful coach in Illinois high school basketball. And he's a big fan of defensive pressure as well. Can you definitely understand why they see it working so well? Loft, little head fake, went off the line. Able to find Dylan Logsden. Great find from Jonah Loft. Great cut from Dylan Logsden.
Really good pass from Loft. Great vision to find the cutting Logsden for a wide open layup.
Lead back down to 1. It's Duff. Kanalikin. Cross court through the hands of Grisham and the Eureka Red Devils forcing a turnover. It's Paquette and Tyson Johnson on for the Beavers. ...22-21, Blackburn leading. 8:47 remaining in the first half. Excuse me. Dylan Logsden, Sam DeJesus, Loft. Brown. Little jab step on Talmadge, giving that lane to himself. Little head fake, a lot of contact. It spins that home.
Impressive finish through contact. Definitely could have been a foul call there. A great finish from Pee-wee Brown, and I mean already in this game, we've seen his craftiness around the rim and in the lane.
Really love that offensive set there from the Red Devils as well. And DeJesus fouling Talmadge. Let him know the quick flex. But yeah, that offensive set I really like from the Red Devils. You can see him kind of spread out. Looked a little bit like a four corners type of thing.
Yeah, definitely the most movement we've seen out of them so far in this game. And that's what we need to see from them is not being stagnant and not kind of standing around. People without the ball moving and setting screens and getting people open.
Quick outlet pass. Brewer not liking what he's seeing. We'll wait for the cavalry to arrive. Dylan Logsden. DeJesus. 8 minutes to go. Loft. Good catch. Logsden trying to work on Johnson. Step back from Logsden. The mid-range knocked in. about that shot, Levi?
I mean, really good step back shot from Dylan Logsdon. I mean, I'm not really sure. It's not a high percentage look, but he got it to fall.
I don't know how Paquette got that one to drop. A couple of crazy shots working out for the better. 7.5 to go in the first. Logs into DeJesus to Brewer. Brewer, a freshman out of Washington. Lost the handle on that. Duff and Brewer scrapping for it. Should be a jump ball eventually. Almost felt like it was a little too quick at times in the women's game, and now it's a little lengthy to wait for that. Kelsey back onto the court for Ishan. 7-17. Remaining in the first half, 26-25. Blackburn on top. Brewer to inbound. Loft, open look from him. Cannot knock it in. It's a good percentage look for Jonah Loft, though.
Yeah, I mean, a good look. He kind of caught it in rhythm, too. It was a good shot. Just unfortunately couldn't get it to fall.
Good take from Duff. Wanted a foul call, but I think with the amount of contact we've seen Pee-wee Brown take also, he's surprising. Brown, tough shot. No good. Ends up being a pass to Jonah Loft. After the backboard assist to Loft. Talmadge. The shake and bake onto Jesus. Tough tank and converting. 3-point lead back in effect for Blackburn. Brown walking this one up. 6-17. Good take from Pee-wee Brown. 10 points from Brown.
And just once again, a really tough take from Pee-wee Brown. We've just seen that all night long so far from him. And I mean, with the pace that he's at to start this game, we could see a big night from him.
Talmadge kicks out. 3-pointer up from Duff. Way too strong. Dylan Logsdon rebounds. Quick break from Brown. Brown pitches back. Jenkins, 3-pointer like from Jonah Loft, letting the people know. On the opposite side, but just like Archer Diacono to Jenkins, the point guard pitching back to the shooting guard, and Brown knocking it off his own leg.
Well, you can just kind of feel the energy in the gym, even though there's not as many students as would be here on a regular night, if you will, with us being in break. You can feel the energy in here. Eureka really starting to build up some momentum, had a few good possessions in a row, really been lighting up the scoreboard all the first half, both teams have. And it's been a very entertaining first half, to say the least.
Cody Bear back on, as well as Ray Banzimuna. His first minutes of the night. Kelsey in the mid-range. The jab step from Duff. Paquette, 3-pointer up, dives. Asking for a foul call, unlikely to get it. Duff ends up just trying to break up that pass instead of catching it. Works out. Talmadge. 5:05 left in the first half. Nice move from Duff, and Banzimuna with a reach. Don't mind that foul given out. Persich coming onto the floor for the Red Devils. Dylan Logsdon off. I believe Pee-wee Brown is the only player in double digits for either team. It's Talmadge in the corner. Johnson to Kelsey. Duff. Talmadge. Able to get inside. It looks like it's a zone being run. Paquette, 3-pointer up from him. No. And another rebound for Pee-wee Brown. Good outlet pass. Ray Banzimuna. Little crossover. Stutter step and blocked. And he caught the block out of bounds.
Yeah, I thought he might have gotten away with a little bit of a walk there before that, too. But, it's kind of a weird play there, but fortunately it's a turnover for the Red Devils.
I've seen some weird plays tonight. Just in this game, the women's game before. You know, it's basketball. Weird things happen sometimes. Talmadge trying to back down Banzimuna. Good hands from him. Forced to kick back out, 11 on the shot clock. Brown tried to jump that pass to the corner. Tyson Johnson from three, no good. Ball tipped. Cody Bear collects. Brewer content to slow this down. For a jump stop, Bear, couple head fakes. Cody Bear, you can tell he's worked on that shot for quite some time.
Yeah, he's really developed his mid-range game very well. Shooting, I don't really know what his percentages are. I don't really have it in front of me. But shooting really well from mid-range and doing a much better job at that this year.
Tyson Johnson can't finish over Brewer. Brewer, a little gimpy coming out of that play. Paquette goes to the floor once again. Banzamuna, bounce pass. Bear, nice take.
Really good fast break run by the Red Devils there. Sharing the sugar, if you will. Again, Coach Willie is still yelling for a foul. Really wanted a foul on that layup by Bear.
3:33 left in the first half. 36-30. Eureka on top. You're watching Eureka College Basketball on ECTV.
What would you give for a child you loved to make their wish come true? To help them fight a critical illness? Just imagine what you'd do. Every single one of us can make the stars align, because when we come together, hope and joy will shine.
Look inside the Red Devil huddle. Up 36-30. With about 3.5 to go in the first half. Spencer Davis, Levi Taylor with you here on ECTV. Pleasure as always. Second time that Blackburn and Eureka have faced off this season. Blackburn taking that first matchup 71-60 at their own house. The Red Devils welcoming them to Eureka and holding a 6-point lead.
Yeah, Eureka doing a really good job defensively. Doing a better job than they were in the first portion of this first half. I thought it was going to be a shootout to start this game. And, you know, Eureka doesn't necessarily shoot well from three, so I thought we might have been in a little bit of trouble. But they've tightened up on defense and done a lot better. And they're running the fast break really well, moving the ball really well on offense.
Brown read that move from Duff extremely well. Pitches back. Banzamuna, jump stop from him. Contact there, can't finish. Bear tries to tip it to himself. It's Barr with the rebound. Blackburn, the ones taking that timeout. Again, Coach Kirby not seeing what he liked. Duff lowers the shoulder, gets to the rim, can't finish around Bear and Brown. Killer Bees is what you should probably call him at this point. Tough take. See Pee Wee Brown a little frustrated with himself after that miss.
Well, he has nothing to be frustrated about with the first half that he's having. He's done really, really well on the floor tonight.
Red Devils back in a man-to-man type of defense. Talmadge trying to force a shot over Banzamuna. Bear, no issues securing a rebound for Cody Bear. Banzamuna, one-on-one, takes it himself, flips it up. Jordan-esque. Can't get it to go down like the aforementioned Michael Jordan. Barr, way too much time at the line, and somehow misses. You know, we talked about hot offensive starts. Both teams kind of cooled down a little bit. Purse is trying to heat back up, and he will do so.
And that's his shot right there. He's a mid-range demon, as I've called him in previous games. He loves that mid-range shot, and rightfully so. He's very good at it.
Under 2 minutes to go in the first half, 38-30. Eureka Red Devils on top. Paquette trying to go left. Trap down low. Talmadge, three-pointer up. That one will spin out. Noah Persich, a rebound. Kind of just looping back behind Paquette. Persich, fade away from him now. Just spins out. Under 90 seconds. Duff. A lot of running start. Blocked by Brown. Talmadge tries to save it. Ends up with Carter. Everyone is just kind of standing around. Carter, 4-on-3. Carter, double clutch. Can't finish. Tipped out. Duff. Duff going to get a full head of steam once again. Kicks out Talmadge. Trying to go around Brown. Can't finish. Persich, another rebound. An outlet pass. Bear. Size up Barr. Goes to the basket. Blocked by Barr. Bear recovers. And should be a tie up there. Again, that's one of those plays that they're taking too long and now tempers are going to boil over. You got to call that a jump ball after, you know, it's a timing call and it's tough to call, but that ball wasn't going to go anywhere between those two guys.
No. Eureka's been doing a good job in this game of running the fast break when they have numbers. The last two possessions, they have not had numbers and they've tried to force things. They need to be more aware of that and be conscious of pulling the ball out and setting up their offense. Their offense has not been bad in this game. They don't need to run the fast break every time down the floor. Be aware of that, be conscious of that, and set up your offense and trust it.
Could be a two-for-one type of situation for Blackburn. It's Cam Johnson back onto the court. He's with it now. Trying to back down Ben Carter, maybe trying to go two-for-one. Gets the lane, kicks out. Grisham. Andrew Coker onto the floor for the first time of the season. Kanalikin trying to back down Coker. Good defense from the sophomore. Duff, head start, trying to get to the cup. Good finish with the left. Red Devils will get the last shot if they want it. A little head sell there from Grisham. 15 seconds on the clock. Brown. Duff guarding him. It's been a fun matchup to watch between those two tonight. Brown trying to get to the bucket, tied up for a moment. Bear tipping it, ends up with Duff, and that will be it. And a little chest bump there. The official separating everybody. 38-32 with some shenanigans after the whistle. Again, like we said, there's no love between these two teams. Levi, good first half for the Red Devils.
Yeah, really good first half. I thought defensively they did a great job tightening up. Offensively, they were moving the ball really well, setting screens really well, moving without the ball very well, better than I have seen them in previous games this season. And as I talked about, they need to clean up the fast break opportunities. Don't go running into something where you don't have numbers. Be smarter about that. But overall, good job in the first half.
Well, that's all we have for your first half coverage. We'll be back on the other side with some first half statistics as well as coverage of the second half. Eureka leading by 6 at halftime.
Got deported. We had a difficult time, and I feel that's why I didn't get to finish school. My husband is really supportive in a way that he pushed me to go back to school.
She wants to have a career so her kids can look up to her.
They both keep me motivated to go to school, and they see that if I do it, like, they can do it too, you know? I feel that everything's possible.
Find free adult education classes near you at finishyourdiploma.org.
Hi there, I'm Sean Sandrock, and I'm a sophomore here at Eureka College, studying political science and history with a pre-law emphasis and music vocal performance, and I'm going to be showing you around campus today. This is Burgess Street, which separates the academic and residential sides of campus. Let's begin our tour here at Dickinson Commons, which is one of our two eating establishments here on campus. It's set up like a food court style, which offers substations, a grill station, pizza, and even a home-cooked meal. We also offer lots of vegan and vegetarian options here on campus. This is Burgess Hall, which houses our social science and business classes. It also contains our professor's offices and student classrooms. Built in 1891, Burgess was originally our library, which since has moved across the street in 1967 to our new library. Did you know on the third floor of Burgess we have a new creative design lab which is designated to all of our art students? This is Melick Library, which has many resources here on Eureka College's campus, including upstairs cubicles, the Gammon Room, which is a lounge area, downstairs classrooms, and the Ronald Reagan Archives. Did you know that President Reagan is a Eureka College alum? If you can't find your book here in the library, we're fortunate enough to be part of the iShare database, which consists of 90 libraries that will find your book and send it here. You may be wondering what classes are like here at Eureka. We usually have a student population of about 500 students, which allows for a lot of individualized attention in the classrooms. Our student to professor ratio is about 13 to 1, which allows students and professors to really get to know each other. We are now coming up on Benham Binkley on my left and Sanders on my right. Benham Binkley was built in 1917, right at the peak of World War I, and Sanders was added on in 2014 with the use of 100% donations given to the institution. This building was awarded Leadership in Energy Environmental Design, which focuses on Sanders being an eco-friendly structure. These buildings are classified as our math and science halls, which house classrooms, professors' offices, and a few science labs. This is Pritchard Theater, which was built right around the same time as Venom Binkley and was originally our sports complex here on campus. The main floor was the gym, and the basement was our swimming pool, where President Ronald Reagan swam as a freshman here on campus. This building is now used for our fine arts classes. Eureka College also played a role in World War II. Enrollment was down due to war efforts, and we were looking for a few new ways to bring in some cash. The college found a program where we could house Nazi German prisoners of war here in the United States. So Pritchard Theater became a holding place for prisoners of war where they would walk down the street during the day and work at the canning factory. The building behind me is the chapel, which is a very historical building here on campus. It is home to our music department. Downstairs includes classrooms, professors' offices, and practice rooms. Upstairs, you will find McAllister Hall, which is where many students perform today. This is the stage where Ronald Reagan gave his first ever speech on behalf of Eureka College's student body. This is the hall where President Reagan discovered his speaking ability. In his 1982 commencement address, he stated, "Everything that's been good in my life began here." Our oldest building behind me was built in 1858. Our administration building, Burris Dickinson, includes the president's office, the provost's office, the business office, alumni and development office, and some staff and professors' offices. If you look at this side of the building, you may notice some things when we reach the other side. Eureka College was founded in 1855 by a group of abolitionists that belonged to the Disciples of Christ Church. We are still associated with the Disciples of Christ Church, but we are now a multi-faith campus, and we welcome all here. Did you know that we were the first institution in Illinois and the third in the nation to admit men and women at an equal basis? Now, if you look at the opposite side of the building, besides the fire escape, you will notice that both sides are exactly the same. This building was here before the town of Eureka had even been established, so they didn't know which way the town was going to expand. So they decided to create two front entrances. This is the Ronald Reagan Peace Garden, dedicated to the life and legacy of President Ronald Wilson Reagan. You will see here a bust of President Reagan, as well as a significantly large piece of the Berlin Wall, which commemorates President Reagan challenging Mikhail Gorbachev to tear down this wall. The garden is a great place to chill out and enjoy the outdoor environment here on campus. Eureka College is the smallest institution to graduate a United States president, which goes to show that all students at Eureka can dream big and fulfill them. We are now looking at the Surf Center, where there are many resources useful for everyone, especially incoming students. This is the Ronald Reagan Museum, which holds over 10,000 artifacts of President Reagan's life here at Eureka. Some were even hand-selected by Reagan himself. The Surf Center also includes the Career Service Center, Becker Auditorium, the Office of Student Life, and our college bookstore. Our final stop in the Surf Center is our second eating establishment here on campus called the Burgoo, named after a stew. The Burgoo is set up more like a store or a restaurant, unlike Dickinson Commons. Some of the students' favorite meals here are cheese sticks, chicken wraps, and Starbucks coffee drinks. While we walk over to the residential side, some students who live close may be wondering, commute or not? About 40% of our students here at Eureka are commuters, which means that all parking on campus is free for all students. Built in 2012, Arnold Hall is our newest residence facility here on Eureka College's campus. These are our most spacious rooms on campus, which is nice when sharing it with a roommate. Arnold Hall consists of 5 wings that each house upper-class residents. Each wing has its own study lounge and larger social lounge with a TV. Every room on campus comes with a bed, chest, desk, bookcase, chair, and closet for each resident. Arnold houses 2 of the 3 sororities on campus. The rooms also include great Ethernet access and high-speed Wi-Fi, as well as geothermal heating and cooling. Arnold also includes a full kitchen and lots of additional lounge and study space, including a media room on the upper level that is perfect for group project work and has a printer free for student use. Behind me is Langston Hall, which is an upperclassman residence facility that offers suite-style living. Langston is co-ed by suite and is set up with 2 single-person rooms that share a toilet and shower in the middle, but have their own sinks in their rooms. It is convenient for upper-class students who would like to live in a quieter environment. Each floor in Langston has a large lounge area with a TV, study, and social space. The lobby area has a couple computers and a printer for student use. This is the Reagan Athletic Complex, dedicated to President Ronald Reagan and his older brother Neil, who also attended the college. Our gym is completely equipped with stadium chairs, which means every chair has a back. We are the only NCAA Division III school to have this luxury. Upstairs, a classroom, some event rooms, and many coaches' offices. The Bonatti Fitness Center is offered free to all students who would like to exercise using machines. Even commuter students have the access to this facility free of charge. Last in this building, our weight room, which is full of new equipment as of fall of 2019. Just outside the Reagan Athletic Complex, we have our football and soccer field, as well as our baseball and softball diamonds. The football and soccer field was converted into AstroTurf, and it also includes a Megatron. Here at Eureka College, we have many different athletic teams that compete throughout various times of the year. To my right is Founders Court, which is predominantly a freshman residence hall. Both of our freshman residence halls are set up to be limited occupancy so students can get to know each other and create a community value. Founders consists of four separate buildings that are all connected by stairwells: Darst, DeWeese, Ford, and Myers. All of our residence halls have access to laundry areas that are free of charge for all students. Founders Court residents use Ben Major just next door for additional lounge space and a large laundry facility. We are now at Alumni Court, which also houses all incoming freshmen. These rooms are comfortably sized for two roommates. Be sure to check your packing list before you come to campus to see what items it is suggested that you bring and what items are not allowed on campus. Connecting both alumni residential buildings is our Learning Center, a great resource to use if you want help with writing or any course, or you could help here by becoming a tutor. The Learning Center is also a great place to study and is open 24/7 for student use. This is Ben Major, named after the man who owned all of the land that Eureka College now sits upon. This is a recreational building here on campus, which gives the students opportunities to chill out, play games, or even watch TV. To finalize our tour, behind me is Gunzenhauser Hall. It was built in 1929. It was extensively remodeled, but we strive to keep the 1920s look with the original wood floors, doors, and pedestal sinks. This concludes our tour here at Eureka College. For more information or to schedule a tour, please visit us online. We hope to see you soon.
Proportion to me is the lived experience of our Division III student athletes. They balance life from an academic perspective and the rigors of competing at a high level, bonding with teammates and building lifelong friendships. But they also are involved in their communities. They work jobs and internships and volunteer. They've learned to be resilient. Diverse experiences are setting them up for the future.
Passion's love. Passion is love for what you do. Because I think when you face challenges, it comes down to how much you want it and how much you love it. Passion is what keeps you going forward. Seeing so many people that were like-minded and so hardworking in their sport and academics, being surrounded by like-minded people makes you want to be more passionate. I think it pushes you to a different level that maybe you didn't think you had. And you can do the best of both worlds and love all of it.
A good citizen is someone who wants to make a positive impact both in their communities and in the world around them. The Division III approach is absolutely the best approach out there for amateur sport because it wants student athletes to explore all parts of who they are. Be successful in the classroom, be successful in competition, be successful in the community. So our student athletes learn what it means to strive for and attain success, but doing it the right way and being good citizens.
Comprehensive learning is being able to adapt to experiences and apply the things that I learned. Being an athlete and juggling academics helped me grow as a person, and things that I've learned, I was able to apply it in another field, putting them into everyday life. Developing comprehensive learning helped me prioritize certain things to make sure I get to where I want to be.
Responsibility is being accountable for your words and actions, first and foremost. It also is an obligation to be a positive influence in the communities around you. Being in a D3 program, you're going to have lots of different opportunities. You're not just an athlete, you're also involved in student life. Your academics are extremely important. We give a lot of our student athletes responsibilities right from the start by giving them leadership opportunities, by having them engage in the community, be a positive influence. That's being a responsible person.
I believe sportsmanship is a It's a mutual admiration and respect for your fellow competitors. We all go through a lot to reach the point where we compete against one another. It's important to realize that. So once we're finally on the field or on the court or on the starting block, we look at each other as fellow human beings and not just competitors. Being able to recognize the hard work that other athletes are putting in creates a more positive and inclusive environment.
College has given me the flexibility to pursue my passions and my interests, and I've recreated my identity for myself aside from just being an athlete.
My greatest personal discovery has been that I am capable of doing things that I didn't know I was capable of doing.
To be able to study what I wanted to and continue to play the sport I love, all of those things came together very nicely in one package in Division III.
I don't think that many kids in my son's school even do it.
He makes fun of his friend who vapes.
He would never try it.
She's into soccer.
She's on the honor roll.
She's just not the type.
No way.
No way.
No way.
No way. My kid would never vape.
Get your head out of the cloud. Today, nearly 8,000 kids will start vaping. Maybe even yours. Learn about the dangers at talkaboutvaping.org.
38-32, the score coming out of halftime. The Eureka Red Devils on top, trying to avenge an earlier season loss, the Blackburn Beavers. Spencer Davis, Levi Taylor with you. And Levi, Red Devils shooting a lot better than they normally do in the first half, from three specifically, but also just from the field.
Yeah, doing a very good job. As I said, moving the ball in their offense, moving around without the ball is the key thing that I haven't really seen from the offense so far this year. They're doing a great job of it in this game today, moving without the ball, creating open shots, doing a really good job on the fast break, and doing a great job defensively. As I talked about earlier, early on in the first half, I thought we were going to have a problem with Blackburn kind of shooting the lights out to start the game. But they really tightened up on D and did a much better job. And, you know, we kind of had an interesting ending to that first half. And I'm anticipating probably a tightly called game by the officials here in the second half.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about it at the very beginning of the game. This is a matchup that neither team are too fond of each other, and we saw that almost boil over at the end of that. There's that play they love to run. Carter, the nice finish there to get the scoring started. The Red Devils love to run that Cody Bear high post pass on the back door to Carter. Three-pointer up from Tyson Johnson, knocked in to respond. Beavers looking to apply a little bit of pressure here. Jalen Johnson back onto the court for the Red Devils. Carter, good footwork there. Kicks back out. It's Bear to Persich. Persich, tough pull-up, jump shot, knocked in. And again, you talked about it. Mid-range demon's the best word for him.
Yeah, just another great mid-range pull-up from Noah Persich. He'll do that a few times a game. He's not going to light up the scoreboard scoring-wise, but he makes a lot of really good plays consistently to help your offense and defense.
Kelsey too strong on that. Duff, an offensive rebound. Cody Bear, a little Alvarado-type steal there on Kelsey. Bear can't finish on the break. Brown knocking it out of bounds. 42-35. Here in the second half, just underway in Eureka, Illinois, at least in the second half part of things. Pee Wee Brown led all scorers with 10 points in that first half to go along with four rebounds. Nice spin move from Talmadge, lost Carter on it.
Really good spin move. Backed him down with a dribble a few times and just spun off of him. And as you mentioned, their guards are good in the post, and we've seen that in this game and saw it right there.
Pee Wee Brown, double clutch, hacked, and foul called. Pee Wee Brown's first trip to the free throw line tonight. We talked about it right before we came back. Pee Wee Brown, just for as much as he goes to the basket and as much contact is handed out, it's a shock that the Red Devils as a team attempted two free throws in that first half.
Yeah, I mean,
only four on Blackburn's side, too, and they're predominantly shooting inside the paint as well.
Yeah, I mean, they really let it go in the first half is what I'm saying. I think the second half you're going to see that it's a lot tighter in terms of foul calls.
Yeah, it was three Blackburn fouls to four Eureka fouls in that first half. Already with one here early on Blackburn. 44-37. Red Devils on top. Kelsey holding the center of the floor. Backdoor cut. Nice play there by Persons to take it away. Persich to Brown. Kelsey forcing Bear out of the post. Brown going to drive. Talmadge ties it up. Kicks out Carter. Three-pointer up from the sophomore. Left short. Pee-wee Brown an offensive rebound. He head fakes. Looks to drive. Floater up from the free throw line from him. And a foul away from the shot. Goes on Isaiah Talmadge. Would not let Cody Bear get his arms up. Which is smart.
Yeah, he's a rebound machine. I guess you got to stop him somehow. Foul him, I guess.
Well, and part of it's not even he's not always rebounding. He's just playing volleyball, and he'll tip it to one of his teammates. There's Cody Bear on, at the rim. That's where he's best at.
Yeah, really good find from Jalen Johnson on the inbounds pass to Cody Bear.
And that's what we've been looking for out of Jalen Johnson. We've kind of just accepted that, he's a guy that can score, but usually isn't trying to score as much, and he's down on the floor right now in some pain. But he's been a great playmaker and ball distributor, and that's really what the Red Devils have been needing. 46-37, 17-27. We're getting Blake Logsdon onto the court. Slow walk off for Johnson.
Yeah, he'll need a few seconds on that sideline. He'll be all right.
Be Paquette to the free throw line after the blocking foul called on Johnson. Rolls off the top of the backboard. Paquette, 83% free throw shooter this season. Granted, only on 6 attempts. That was 7-8. Reduces the Eureka lead to 8 after those free throws. There's Carter. Brown to Logsdon. Blake Logsdon trying to take Johnson on the dribble. Cody Bear knocked out of his hands, and they're going to say it was off of a member of the Beavers. Not sure who exactly, but very close to taking a deflection off of Bear.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. It went off of his foot for sure. Must have touched it before it went out of bounds or touched it while he was out of bounds, but might be some blood on the floor or something.
Does appear to be the case. Nevi, this is just a little thing. Noah Persich not letting Paquette get behind him.
No, it's one of those
blood was on the floor, ball was not in play, and Persich was still down there with him.
Yeah, it's one of those mind game mental things that, hey buddy, no matter what, I'm not. Not letting you get behind me.
Persich with the ball, guarded by Duff. Nice move from Persich. Good rebound there from Paquette. It's Duff in transition. It's Talmadge attacking the rim. Good finish there for Isaiah Talmadge. And that's where a lot of these Blackburn guards are at their best, is getting at that rim.
Yeah, we've seen that all night from them. Both these teams really like to take the ball to the rack. And Blackburn is not a bad three-point shooting team, but they would prefer to take the ball to the basket. Done a good job of it tonight. And already, Spencer, we're seeing that it is being a much tighter called second half than it was in the first half.
5-point lead for the Red Devils. A few ticks over, 3 minutes played in the second half. Blake Logsdon calling Ben Carter to give him a screen. Picks up his dribble. Needs to find somebody, tipped away from Carter for a moment, knocked out of his hands, and will go out of bounds. Tell the Blackburn bench, loving it. And again, you can see that they get a lot of their identity from those gritty types of plays.
Yeah, they put a lot of pressure on the ball handlers. They put a lot of pressure on the guards, on the wings. They're trying to force you to make mistakes passing the ball and create turnovers and fast breaks.
Blake logs into Ben Carter. Carter lobbing down to the post. Bear lost it to tough pass to reel in. 3-on-3. Tyson Johnson goes back to Paquette into the corner. Grisham onto the court for the first time in the second half. Talmadge could not bring that in. Diving for it. Persich. Talmadge lowers the shoulder for a moment. Couple bumps. Nice finish for Isaiah Talmadge.
Blackburn really starting to have their way offensively. Eureka needs to do a better job tightening back up as it did in the first half.
Talmadge up to 16 points tonight. Carter without points, something that's pretty rare in the stretch that he's been having. But a very good third option so far. Brown blocked there by Barr. Good spin move from Talmadge. Going to the corner for Paquette. Looking to drive, kick out Grisham. Spin move on Logsdon, and he finishes. Lead cut down to just one. And a timeout taken by Coach Wilde, 46-45. Red Devils still up. 15-34, and the Beavers starting to close it on ECTV.
Affects all corners of the world for good. I mean, if you think about organizations that affect an entire world, it's a short list. Taking care of kids is a priority. Taking care of the families as whole.
Without donations, without people that care for St. Jude and for the kids in St. Jude, our Max wouldn't be here.
You are making a difference, not just in a hospital, but in an entire world.
Welcome back to the Christine Bonatti Bullwinkle Arena. The Red Devils holding a one-point lead over the Beavers of Blackburn. Plenty of time left in the second half. Glad you're joining us, Spencer Davis and Levi Taylor with you. And Levi, Blackburn certainly throwing the haymakers early on in this second half.
Yeah, like I said, really having their way offensively. Doing a great job defensively as well against the Red Devils' offensive attack. You know, Red Devils kind of going away from the ball movement and the and just really the offensive movement in general that they had in the first half. Starting to become stagnant again. As they did at the beginning of the first half, really need to turn it around, tighten up defensively, start to move the ball better on offense as they did towards the second half of the first half, if you will.
Banzamuna on for the Red Devils. And Cam Johnson also out there for Blackburn. Slightly different group for both teams. It's Blake Logsdon harassed by Tyson Johnson. Bear able to reel it in, finally tips it up into the air to Barr. We have 3-on-1. Paquette back. Johnson able to readjust. Beavers back in front by one. Brown looking to post up on Grisham. Spin move, double teamed in the post, and he is fouled. Go to the free throw line for two shots. Give it to Otis Grisham.
Another take from Pee Wee Brown to the basket where he got contact. Got a call that time. Didn't know who he was at first. Kind of delayed call. Was a little worried that that he wasn't going to get that one. And I think Coach Willie would have had a few words to say had he not gotten that one.
Usually Coach Willie's pretty vocal, but certainly seems like he likes to express his displeasure if things not quite going the way that he think it should. That one rolls off, tied up at 47. Grisham lost the handle on it, able to pick up Barr to Johnson. Grisham, pass almost picked off, three-pointer up from him, blocked by Bear. Blake Logsdon keeping it in bounds. Persich, able to get to the middle of the floor, probing, mid-range shot from him, spins home.
Once again, that mid-range shot. I mean, you might see him take a few threes here and there. You might see him take the ball to the basket a few times here and there. But, I mean, the majority of the shots that he's going to be taking are in that mid-range section. And he is killer from there.
Banzamuna called for a foul, a reach, if you will. Three fouls to three. You can see Coach Kirby kind of showing Grisham what he wanted him to be doing in terms of body positioning. DeJesus on for Blake Logsdon. Lobbed into Tyson Johnson. Brady Barr, he can shoot. Gets Bear up in the air. Excuse me, Grisham, three-pointer from the corner. No good, and rebounded Cody Bear. Quick outlet, Persich. Persich fakes the usage of a screen, dribbles all the way around, gets that mid-range spot again, knocked in. You can tell he's hunting it.
It's just lights out, dude. I mean, you know the spot that he's going to go to. You know the shot that he's going to take, and he's still going to hit it in your face every time.
You can see Coach Kirby kind of just flinging his papers down. A sense of, like, I don't know what we can do. Just keep him away from that spot. Tough bucket there from Beavers, back within a possession. Persich, good move. Johnson trying to guard him. Cross court, DeJesus, three-pointer from him. Too strong. It's one of those kind of plays when Noah Persich start getting that glint in his eyes. You know, things are about to get devious. Cam Johnson gets Brown up in the air, tries to readjust. Good box out immediately from Brown. Brown, good defense from Tyson Johnson. Brown, tough take to the basket, gets his own miss. A lot of contact, brought back down, and finishes there.
I just don't understand how there's no call at all. I mean, not even a jump ball, not a travel, not a foul, just nothing. I mean,
unless they're saying it left his hands and got blocked directly back into them, I guess that's the only explanation. Cam Johnson, three-pointer, knocked in. Beavers within one. You can see that the Red Devils really like Noah Persich in that one guard type of role right now.
Yeah, I mean, he does a good job, and he, along with the mid-range game that he has great court vision and a good knowledge of how to facilitate the offense.
One of those guys that's been here for a long time. Barr almost had his pocket picked. Chance for the Beavers to go back up. 12:03 remaining in the second half. Grisham. Guarded by Brown. Able to get Brown to go by him. Banzamoon, a good challenge, but a good finish from Grisham.
Really good pump fake to get Pee-wee Brown in the air. Pee-wee's a really good shot blocker, so to get him up in the air, that kind of takes that away.
Persich, fade away from him off the front of the rim. Johnson. Konalikin wide open from three, and a fortunate miss for the Red Devils. Banzamuna. Brown now in the post. They're going to work on Grisham. Got the better of Grisham on the last play. Does so there. Konalikin came down, and that will be two free throws, and that one's hard to argue.
Yeah, there's not much discussion to have there. Definitely a foul.
53-54, Blackburn up. Four guys coming in off the bench. In just a moment, Micah Brewer coming on for the Red Devils, the lone sub. And a little toilet bowl action there for Brown. He called it short, wrong. In would have been a better option.
Basically a 5-for-5 substitution for Blackburn, I think. They subbed everybody out except for...
Looks like Cam Johnson.
I believe you're right.
But yeah, Paquette, Duff, Talmadge, and Ishan onto the court. Again, Micah Brewer, the lone sub for the Red Devils. He'll spell Noah Persich, 1-for-2 on that trip. Brown frustrated. Got his hands on his hips. You know something bad's going to happen for the offense. Duff going to work. The corner, Talmadge. Good ball movement here from the Beavers. Johnson, a back down Brown. Got a guy that can really work it well. And a foul, and the bucket is good. Again, Cameron Johnson likes to get down low. And he can finish close to that rim.
Yeah, a really tough take. I mean, definitely fouled. Pee-wee's was for sure holding on the arms. But a really tough take, a really tough bucket to convert on, and hats off to him for doing so.
Ball pops out, Talmadge to the bucket, misses the shot, tipped around. Bear able to volleyball it out. Brown saw the pass well, still on the ground. Talmadge and Banzamuna diving for it. Cross court, Paquette, Johnson. And Duffel reset. Heady play there from the Beavers. Got an energy play. Now a good look on offense. Duff. Good move over Banzamuna and almost blew the roof off for the Beavers.
Yeah, you really, all the momentum was with Eureka earlier on in this game, earlier on in this half, really. But you really felt a shift in momentum from Eureka over to Blackburn. They've kind of taken over this game, and as I said, they've had their way here in the second half. Eureka needs to come up with something to thwart the effort of the Beavers.
And again, you know, we talked about it, the women's game, basketball is a game of runs. So while the Beavers are using one right now, for sure, as long as you can limit the damage, you go on one of your own shortly enough. 2 for 2 on that trip. It's a 4-point lead for Blackburn now. It's going to be a young backcourt for the Red Devils. They're going to let Cody Bear bring this one up. The oldest one, of course, just nullifying anything I just said. Micah Brewer, the freshman, to the sophomore Logsdon. Here's Bear, backdoor cut from Dylan Logsdon. Cross court, Brewer, quick fire three from the freshman! Knocked it in, it should have been a foul too.
Yeah, definitely should have been a foul. I'm not really sure how that wasn't called. He went to the floor right after the shot. No call.
Halfway through the second half, 58-57, Blackburn. Geishan handing off Cam Johnson. We're going to dance with Banzamuna. Backing him down, getting to his spot, a little fade away. Good box out from DeJesus and collects. Dylan Logs in middle of the floor. Nice spin move, thought about a shot. Elects to kick out instead, Brewer. Run off the line by Paquette. Brewer, tough take. Logs into Banzamuna, run off the line. Trying to get to the bucket, contact from Banzamuna and gets it to go down. Eureka back in front.
Really tough take from Banzamuna. A lot of contact there and fought through it. Was able to convert on the layup.
Duff sizing up Logsdon, goes straight through Logsdon. Charge drawn. As free as it gets when you see Logsdon get, you know, that was one of those Logsdon was like, I know what he's about to do. And just stood his ground and down he goes.
I mean, we've seen Dylan Logsdon do that several times this year. It's not the first time and it dead sure won't be the last time we see him do that.
Much to the chagrin of the rest of the Slyak, I imagine. 59-58, Eureka up. 9:08 left in the second half. It's Cam Johnson and Eshan to the bench for Blackburn. It's Grisham and Tyson Johnson back onto the court. Micah Brewer, the freshman. It's DeJesus, backdoor cut. Banzamuna, dump off pass. Bear with the jam.
Well, that's the ball movement I'm talking about that I want to see from Eureka's offense. Moving without the ball, moving with the ball, setting screens, moving around. Really good ball movement on that offensive possession from Eureka. Need to see that more from them.
8:40 to go in the second half. 3-point lead for the Red Devils. Grisham steps behind the arc. Splash. Cuts down the crowd noise for a little bit. Brewer able to lose Tyson Johnson. Logsdon. Bear. Banzamuna. Trying to get some space. It's Bear extending the range from the arc. Left short. DeJesus fought for a moment. Duff willing to take on Bear. Stuffed by Bear. Misses the tip in. Pass almost picked off Logsdon. Logsdon in the open court. Banzamuna back to Logsdon. Bear in the mid-range. Quick fire from the big man. Missed. Tyson Johnson the rebound. Tied up at 61, 7:48 left in the second. Grisham, good crossover. Kicks back out, Talmadge, 16 to his name. A little hop step. Able to get Bear up in the air and a foul that you have to commit. That's only Bear's first, nothing to be concerned about.
No, I mean, we're in a really good position as far as it goes with Bear's foul count. Usually at this point in the game, we're a little worried about his foul count, but he's done well today.
Chance for Talmadge to put his guys up. 7:31 left in the second half. been a back and forth game. Again, if this, I don't think there's a better game that epitomizes a game of runs more than this. Both teams trading momentum. Huey Brown back onto the court. Student section causing some noise and a miss. Brewer with a rebound. Brewer working on Tyson Johnson. Good cut from Dylan Logsdon up to the glass. A lot of contact, no whistle. 7-16, Otis Grisham. A little hesitation move, and Duff going to reset. Johnson. Duff guarded by Bear. Talmadge now. Grisham looking to post up Talmadge on Brown. Chucks it off of him, and it will be Blackburn ball still. Talmadge and Brown with a little mutual respect type of moment. You know Brown would have done the same thing.
Yeah, we've seen him do it several times.
Under 7 minutes to go. Quick inbound. Grisham, three-pointer up. No, and a rebound from Bear. Overhead pass. Brewer. Brewer thought about a transition three. Alexa floater, and Micah Brewer with 5 points and a timeout by the Red Devils. Up two with 6:45 to go here in Eureka. Fourth slack game of the year, and if you're watching, you're having a good time right here on ECTV.
What would you give for a child you loved to make their wish come true? To help them fight a critical illness? Just imagine what you'd do. Every single one of us can make the stars align, because when we come together, hope and joy will shine.
'63-'61, Red Devils up two with 6:45 to go in the second half. Spencer Davis, Levi Taylor with you. Levi, this matchup was decided 71-60 earlier on in December, but certainly looks like we're cruising for a higher scoring affair.
Oh, definitely. I mean, the first half was pretty high scoring. Both offenses have really been hot in this game. Really, I thought it was going to cool down at some point, but it hasn't so far. It's been a very, very, very exciting, very high-intensity game. And, I mean, that's the matchup we were looking for between these two teams.
Yeah, the students that have, you know, still here on campus providing some good noise, and the fans, you know, they're just from the community or family members also doing a great job of making this feel like a den to defend. The Red Devils look to do just that. 6:45 left in the second half. The Otis Grisham to walk it up for the Beavers. Tyson Johnson. Jonah Loft onto the court for the first time in this second half for the Red Devils. Down low, Talmadge. Trying to back down DeJesus. Able to get a shot up and a rebound from Pee Wee Brown. And trips DeJesus, and that should be a technical foul as well.
Looks like they're going to have a discussion on whether it will be or not.
Or a flagrant one, perhaps, if the ball's in play.
Could be.
Oh, just a common foul. Coach Kirby trying to argue that. I don't think you can really argue that one, to be honest. That was a...
And on the other side, you got Coach Wilde asking for an explanation on why it wasn't a technical foul.
I guess. It was certainly a tripping motion. It was pretty blatant.
And we could use those points at the line right now.
No kidding. One foul away, either team from the bonus. Micah Brewer to Loft. Loft looking to drive. Gets the lane, kicks out. Micah Brewer relocating. Three-pointer from the freshman. Not good. And rebounded by Duff. Crucial minutes here. Persich and Bear getting a break. Big minutes for the Eureka bench. It's Grisham trying to lose Dylan Logs and poked out from behind by Brown. And again, not a play that Brown gets really credited with much, except for maybe a pass deflected, but a play disruption should be a stat that we start taking into consideration. Johnson all the way to the bucket, can't finish near the rim. Talmadge over the trees and finishes. Coach Wilde not happy.
As he usually is.
Yeah, usually if I can hear Coach Wilde's voice through my headset, it's not because he's very happy something just happened.
He doesn't get too excited on the happy side of things, but he gets pretty riled up when he doesn't like the call.
Counter, he got very excited early on in this game in a good way. But it is a one-point lead for Blackburn. It's Micah Brewer picking up his dribble. It's Loft. Loft, they're going to drive all the way to the bucket. Tough take. Not quite enough mustard on that.
That was a good take, and it was a good look. Just unfortunately, the bounce on the rim. The rim said no to him.
Tyson Johnson, open look from three, rattles home. Blackburn in front, four. Big offensive possession for the Red Devils. Pee Wee Brown in possession. Duff picking him up, screen from DeJesus. Brown tries a Euro step, stuffed by Talmadge. Three on one break, Duff. Grisham slides out of bounds. And a fortunate break there for the Red Devils and a miscue in transition for Blackburn.
Yeah, and they don't make too many of those. They're really, really good in the fast break, usually pretty efficient. But right there, Eureka gets a break and new life on offense.
Loft and Brewer coming out of the game. It's Bear and Persich back on. Yet another game where it seems like everybody that's checking in for the Red Devils already has points. And that's a very welcome sign. We're in a couple games early on in the season. I believe there's only four or five players per game scoring. Noah Persich. DeJesus, Brown down low. Trying to get by Grisham. A lot of contact. They will get a foul eventually. It seems like, again, this is just a theory. Theory will only take you so far. It seems like it's just one foul for one team and then one foul for the next. One team, one team, one team, one team. 7-7. Seems like it's been like that the entire half.
Yeah, at least they're calling it even. That's all we can really ask from, I guess.
Coach Wilde would beg to differ.
Correct.
As a non-biased party, of course.
Right. Right. Coach Wilde has no horse in the race here.
Of course. Brown up to 17 points after that free throw. Lead of Blackburn cut down to 2. 4 minutes and 35 seconds left. It's been a fun night of basketball so far. Eureka coming back from a 10-point deficit. Probably should have been a push-off there on Grisham. That would go against the 1-to-1 rule. Good crossover from Grisham. Trying to get that left hand, puts it up. Through contact, no call. And the ball bounces out of bounds. It'll be Eureka ball. Feels like a little bit of a lack of call as a makeup call for not calling the push off.
Yeah. Longston was just laying on top of Grissom.
Pancake.
There was no call. Yeah, pancake. I want another football reference. We were making a lot of those during the women's game.
Ben Carter also back onto the court for the Red Devils. Persich picked up Tyson Johnson. Persich to Bear, getting a screen from DeJesus. Bear, mid-range jump shot from the big man. DeJesus, really close to that line, was Duff. Poked out from behind. Johnson kind of stuck his foot out there. It's Brown attacking Duff to the basket. Nice finish from Brown, and kind of hobbling. Might have landed on somebody's foot on the way down.
Yeah, really good take from Brown. He's up to 20 points now on the night. He started this game off hot. I thought he might have scored 40.
Talmadge, really good finish around Bear. 69-67, Blackburn. Persich. Tyson Johnson's got a tough job, man. His job is just to run back and forth and try to make the ball handler's life difficult. Brown to Carter. Carter, really get some separation. 11 seconds on the shot clock. Kick ball by Talmadge. Levi, thoughts on the kick ball? Dirty, clean play, smart play, not smart play?
I mean, it's
in general.
It's like a pass breakup, that just tipping it out of bounds. I don't think it's a dirty play at all. I think it's. I mean, there were several times in when I was playing that I would just stick my foot out there and try to break up a pass. It gives you a break and makes them reset.
Speaking of reset, it's a reset of the shot clock as well. 13 seconds on it now. Ben Carter, guarded by Talmadge, 9 seconds on the shot clock. Post touch, bear, contact there on the floor, so it will be 1-1 free throws, though, for the big man.
Well, the 1-for-1 foul count thing is still in effect.
I might be cooking. Bear 1-of-2 on his first trip. Knocks in that one. They might have called that in the act of shooting. I could be wrong. Nobody moved. Sometimes people get confused, though, when it's a bonus and non-bonus free throws. That one downed as well. Tied up at 69. 2:54 left in the second half. Micah Brewer on for Ben Carter. The way that Micah Brewer has been playing, you know, 5 points for the freshman. Some pretty big minutes. He got a tough ask with Cam Johnson. Darius Duff, kick, corner, bar run off the line. Cross court with Johnson. 15 seconds on the shot clock. Tyson Johnson crossing over. It's Barr. Traveled.
Yeah, as you talked about, Michael Brewer, the freshman, really put it in some solid minutes tonight. And as you mentioned, several players getting in the scoring column tonight as opposed to 4 or 5 or 6 players. Several players getting in on the love tonight. And that's what you need as a basketball team. You need guys that you can look to come off the bench, or even that fourth or fifth guy in the starting lineup that can provide some points.
2:20 left in the second half. Pee Wee Brown holding, 12 seconds on the shot clock. Micah Brewer kicks to Jesus. Persich, 6 on the shot clock. Getting a screen, deep 3 from Persich. No good. Duff keeping it in bounds, tipped out of Brown's hands to Barr. See, DeJesus almost laid down the hammer. Cam Johnson, bounce pass. Brewer back into the play and could not quite pick it off. Persich clearing Brown out. We get to the middle of the lane, pitches back. Bear, spin move. Through Barr, bucket is good. Tied back up at 71.
That's a big play from Bear right there. Coming down the stretch, being physical at the rim. As we said, he does a great job finishing strong at the rack. Uses that 6'10 frame to do so.
17 points on the night for Cody Bear. Spoils split, 71. And Bear moving his guys in front by one now. 1:42 left in the second half. Red Devils on top. Tyson Johnson guarded by the freshman Micah Brewer. Duff looking to set a screen for him. Currently with it. Back out, Talmadge. With a drive on Bear, lowering the shoulder. Now ready to post up. Tall man guarding him. Great finish by Isaiah Talmadge. Brewer, nice little handle there. Almost lost it for a moment. Brown, minute 12. Screen from Bear. Brown poked loose. Looked like it went off of the foot of somebody. I think we had the best view of the house on that, to be honest.
I think we might have.
So I had to let the officials know.
It's not often that we have the best view in the house.
It's rolling pretty much, not necessarily right in front of us, but we had that upper angle on it. Persich to Brown, 11 on the shot clock. 1 minute to go, Brown from three. Yes, Pee Wee Brown putting the Red Devils up 2. 53 seconds to go. Duff centering the ball. Beavers trailing by 2. Duff gonna have to shake Pee Wee Brown. Now Noah Persich. Persich stepped over the line. It should be over the back. It's picked off anyway. Persich, Talmadge behind, and it's a wedgie. Oh my goodness.
And that's gonna be a Blackburn ball because that's a jump ball.
Yeah. a block wedgie to get the ball back with 34.6 left. And Levi, that seemed like a missed call right here and over in the back.
It definitely was a missed call. I'm not sure how they missed it, but regardless, here we are.
Especially with the bright pink shoes of Duff.
No, it's not like it blends in with the floor or anything.
We'll see. 2-point lead for the Red Devils, 31 seconds left. Shot and game split by 4 seconds. Talmadge looking for head of steam. Outside, Cam Johnson from three, puts him up one. Brewer looking to dance on the perimeter and a foul committed, and that's going to be 2 shots for Micah Brewer.
You talk about putting a freshman in a big spot.
These will be Micah Brewer's first collegiate free throws. With 15.3 seconds left, his team trailing by one. Brewer with 5 points tonight. Again, any foul committed by Blackburn sends Eureka to the line for 2 shots. 1-1 free throws still if Eureka fouls Blackburn. Brewer missing both and a rebound from Cam Johnson. It will be Cam Johnson to take the free throws. Probably the worst possible time to get your first shots, to be honest. They're saying Talmadge was the man fouled. Levi, I don't know if I was wrong. I thought for sure it was Cameron Johnson who got that rebound.
It was. I'm not really sure.
Well, it's a good switch. Talmadge shooting 74% from the free throw line. Cam Johnson shooting 50. See if it pans out for him. 1-1 free throws. First one converted. 26 points from Isaiah Talmadge tonight. And also, the clutchest block of his career. Misses the free throw. Red Devils down 2. Brown picked up by Talmadge. Looking to go downhill. Able to get all the way to the bucket. A lot of contact. Oh, and a hard shot. The head off the metal. Went full tilt down there. Everyone checking on Pee Wee Brown right now. Again, foul committed there. So it will be 2 shots for Brown or his replacement. .9 seconds remaining in the second half. Brown up to his feet, or almost up to his feet, at least up to his seated position. Again, a strong take from Pee Wee Brown. He got the clearing in the lane, which was surprising. Everyone fanned out for him.
Yeah, they just cleared out, let him go ISO on it.
I don't know if that was intentional or not to not have help side defense on Pee Wee Brown, but Brown up to his feet eventually. We'll see if they let him take the free throws. Red Devils are going to take a timeout, I believe, so that he can take those free throws. Again, if a head injury occurs, they have to take him out of the game, but you might be able to nullify it if there's a timeout. It's kind of like Shohei Ohtani's contract situation. There's some loopholes you can find.
I'm not really sure. He's back there with the trainers right now getting looked at.
I don't know what the discussion is at the scorer's table. He was in the act of shooting. It should be 2 shots regardless. And even if there was a foul committed, it's still 2 shots, the double bonus.
Yeah, it doesn't really matter either way.
But we've got it figured out up top. We'll give him some time to figure it out down there. 6.9 seconds left. Levi, that last set offensively, really the shot you want, the best possible shot you could have gotten.
Yeah, I mean, great look. Just, if he would have been able to get that one to go, that would have been pretty sweet. But unfortunately, he wasn't able to. Hopefully, he's all right. He hasn't come out on the floor yet. There he is.
Pee-wee Brown will be the man to take these two free throws again. Another foul by Eureka is 1-1 free throws for Blackburn. Pee-wee Brown, junior out of Peoria, Illinois, by way of Lincoln College. Shot some clutch free throws in his career before. Why not add a couple more to your name? And that one spins out. And another timeout taken by Coach Wilde. And it will be a full timeout, 77-75. We'll let the tension build. 6.9 remaining here in Eureka. You're watching Eureka College Basketball on ECTV.
We're just trying to keep things running for those who rely on us. That's why we don't have time to be sick with the flu.
We don't have time for delays.
Ready!
We don't have time for spills.
Next.
We don't have time for setbacks. Let's be real.
Getting the flu shot
helps you fight the flu.
Get a flu shot for yourself and those around you, too.
Look inside Coach Wilde's, not necessarily mine, but at least what's going on in the huddle. As this team trails two, Pee-wee Brown, one free throw remaining for Pee-wee Brown. Also one timeout for the Red Devils, five for Blackburn. Foul sitting at 10-8. Blackburn with 10, Eureka with 8. So a foul from Eureka forces 1-1 free throws on the side of the Beavers. Pee-wee Brown out there for one more shot. Stage has been set for a dramatic finish. 10th of a second under 7 left. There's a split trip. Red Devils will trail. Talmadge trapped in the corner. Pass tip. Duff. Man, fouled there by Brewer. 2.5 left. So Darius Duff will go to the free throw line now. Again, the Red Devils with one timeout remaining. I imagine they'll use it regardless of how this free throw turns out. Duff shooting 60% on his free throws on the season. I believe this is his first trip to the line tonight. No, he had one earlier on in the game. I apologize. First one knocked home. Two for two. Coach Wilde will take a timeout. We're going to stay here for this one. 3-point lead for Blackburn. Levi. Red Devils going to bring Jonah Loff on as expected, a 3-point shooter. How are you getting the ball to half court to give yourself more of a chance?
A series of screens and a long pass, at least one. You have to make at least one long pass. I mean, you're not... You could try to get the ball up the floor in 2.5 seconds. You probably could do it. But that makes for a long shot and a shot on the run. So I'm probably trying to get the ball from out of bounds to the half court line and get a screen for somebody and a quick pass and a quick shot. Because, I mean, that's really all you have time for. But the Red Devils had a chance to not put themselves in this position. Free throws are a big part of the game. Being at the line, and if you don't cash in on free shots, then those start to add up. And this game is a whole lot different if we're making free throws down the stretch.
It's a 3-point lead for Blackburn, 2.5 seconds remaining in the second half. Blackburn trying to go 2-0 against the Red Devils this season. It'll be Sam DeJesus to inbound. Jesus giving baseline, looking to one hand this one up the floor, into the middle floor. Pass picked off by Tyson Johnson, and that will do it. And Blackburn escapes Eureka with a 79-76 victory. And as exciting of a matchup as you can get. But that finish is really highlighted by that Darius Duff sliding down in the middle of the floor. Looked like his foot might have crossed half court. Persich picking the ball up. And then a block from Isaiah Talmadge to wedgie it and get the ball back for his guys.
Yeah, I mean, you could blame it on the ref, I guess, for missing the call at half court. But, I mean, you can't miss that many free throws down the stretch and think that you're going to win. You can't. It's not going to happen.
A three-point win for Blackburn. As fun of a game as you can get. 79-76, our final here from Eureka, Illinois. That's all we have for you in terms of this matchup, but our next broadcast of Eureka College basketball will be on Friday, December, I believe it's 16th, 15th, apologies. No, it is December 16th, apologies. December 16th, when the Red Devils travel to Monmouth to take on the guys' team for the second time of the season. That tip-off time set for 7 o'clock can be found on WEUR. On behalf of our entire crew, my broadcast partner, Levi Taylor, this is Spencer Davis. Thank you for joining us. Have a great evening.